need to do like stream HD.
Mug, excuse me, MD Lug for January 2015.
Okay. Well, thanks, Gib. I think we all know each other, but I'm Kevin O'Brien, and among other things, I am the tech track coordinator for PenguinCon. Mm-hmm. So, anyone ever wants to do a tech presentation, I'm more than happy to receive that. And I also do a lot of recording for Hacker Public Radio. I think the last time I was here, I did a presentation on LibreOffice, which is one of the series. The other one I've been doing is one on security, and you can see some of the stuff there that I've worked on. You know, encryption and email and hashing and passwords and SSH tunneling is what I'm working on right now. So what we're going to do today is a presentation on passwords. This presentation, the slide deck is on SlideShare. It's linked and, in fact, embedded on my website. All of my stuff is licensed Creative Commons Attribution Sharealike.
Okay.
So you're probably familiar with that, but what Attribution Sharealike means is there's only two limitations. One is you can't take my name off of it. So if you use it, you have to give me credit for doing it. And Sharealike means if I'm giving you all of these rights, you have to give them to anyone else if you use this in any way. Not that, you know, you probably would, but, you know, I mean, you could take this presentation and share it. If you were to give this presentation somewhere, you couldn't say to people, no, you can't have it. Because I've already made it publicly.
I was going to say, it'd be hard to do that.
Yeah. And you couldn't, like, change the first slide to take my name off. So if you want, Gib, you could put a link to this on the MDLUG site or download a copy and store it on the MDLUG site or whatever you want to do. I don't particularly care. So with that, let's get to the presentation itself. One other thing. I think this could be a good candidate for something we could do for the library patrons. Would you think about that as we go through the presentation?
So I'm willing to just accept that as a good thing to do and put it on a list.
Okay.
So the list now consists of one thing. So
well,
we are looking very, very desperately for ideas.
Yeah. The only limitation for me is that it would have to be a Saturday. During the week, I'm just waiting.
All right, well, that means we can't do it during the summer because they're closed on the Saturdays
right.
In the summer. Okay, so soon.
But we could, yeah. We
February, could something like that?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it kind of sounded like they would love to have a few things on their schedule. So.
Right, yes.
March and April might be busy for them.
Mm-hmm. So with that, this presentation, basically, I'm looking at two sides of this. Passwords, for most people, is a matter of accessing resources on the web. And so we're talking about client-server kind of environment. There is a remote server somewhere out there in the cloud, as we say. And it has resources that you want to access. And in order to get to those resources, you need to authenticate using a password. So the question of what happens on the server is of some interest. So let's take a look at that. Your password is stored on a server. How securely is it being stored? All right. Well, if there's a password involved, presumably one of the things you want to do is you want to have control about who has access. Obviously, if I'm logging into my bank, I want to make sure I'm the only one that can log into that particular account. I would be very upset if other people were doing that, right?
Yeah.
So a password is one way of securing that, but some places are not quite that important. Now let's take a look at the site owner. The site owner controls access to the resource. So they decide, basically, how this is going to work. Your only choice, if you're going to use this resource, is to choose the password you're going to use, and that may be subject to particular conditions that the site owner places. So it might be a certain minimum length, character set, you know, must include upper and lower case, numbers, blah, blah, blah. And then it's up to the site owner to secure and protect all of that information. Some of them do. Many do not. And obviously at this point we all know that if it was Sony, good luck. Threats. When it comes to password security, you are always the weakest link here. Mm-hmm. All right. For instance, social engineering is a good one. This still continues to work over and over again. Right? Hi, I'm Ted from IT and I need to verify your password. Could you tell that to me? A lot of people still fall for stuff like this. Right? Or an email with a clickable link. We've noticed a pattern of unusual activity. We need to investigate. Please click this link so we can perform an analysis. People still fall for stuff like that. Now, one of the things we need to consider, social engineering is retail. You're going after a person's password. Generally speaking, most of the problems we have these days are hackers that want to go wholesale. They want to get millions of passwords. So, you're only a good individual target if you become a gateway to something that is compelling. Hackers in Belarus are not going to put in a huge amount of time trying to get into my bank account. Because there's not that much money to begin with. Right? But if they can get a database with a million bank accounts and can find a way to get into 50% of them, the math starts to look good. Now, there are cases where an individual target can be very lucrative. Do you remember some years ago when RSA got hacked, the company RSA, you
know, yes.
They provide those
yes.
little tokens you
right.
use.
Right, the secure ID we called them,
secure
right?
Secure ID tokens, and they got hacked, and it was basically an email that got to a secretary in RSA with one of those, we need you to click on this link to blah, 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 and she did. They got in, and they got the keys. Which, if you're RSA, that's like the worst possible outcome, because the keys are the crown jewels.
So it was social engineering? It wasn't like a real lack of security that they...
Yeah, and you know, you don't have to be the most important person if, for some reason, like one of the things with Sony, we took a look at the Sony hack, one very clear problem was that at Sony, they did not have really rigorous access controls within the company. So if you're inside the firewall at all, you had access to just about everything. Right? So very poor security practices at Sony. Now, you might have something really valuable if you were in a company that had decent access controls, but you are an executive, you might have access to things like bank account information, intellectual property information, stuff like that. So, this is mostly a matter of money these days, okay? There was a time some years ago, when hacking was about bragging rights and lulls and stuff like that, that's not where things are going these days. There's occasionally a little bit of that, but most of it is trying to get a business database, all right? So, recent ones, Home Depot, Target, Jimmy John's,
Kmart.
Yeah, a lot of it is through point of sale systems, because the point of sale systems are connected to the corporate network. They don't have good segregation, and so that just was the weak entry point that crackers could use. And one of the big problems is that companies are largely escaping liability. Now, I think that's going to change, all right? Target is being sued by a number of banks who are saying, no, we shouldn't have to bear the cost from this because Target was not doing the things they were supposed to do. You know, they were not following best security practices, they were negligent. And this creates what we call moral hazard in economics.
I would think they've got a case where they could even lose their merchant account because they weren't following PCI guidelines by segregating out their networks.
Right. PCI, payment card industry. So that's what that refers to there, not the computer PCI term. This creates moral hazard because companies, if they don't pay the penalty, they won't spend the money to fix things. Now, those of us in IT know the perennial problem is when you bring up security concerns, that goes down here somewhere on the list of corporate priorities. It's always like, no, you know, yeah, that's an interesting problem, but we still got to make our quarterly numbers and goose our sales and blah, blah, blah. Now, one of the problems we run into is password proliferation. And just about every site you go to demands a login and a password to do just about anything. Mm-hmm. This creates problems because people are not really good with passwords.
Right.
And I don't think people are going to change noticeably in the next few years. As far as I can tell, we've been pretty much the same for thousands of years. I don't expect any major changes.
So the caveman used a chisel and stone to put his passwords on the cave wall. And
so here's a typical password requirement. Every password must contain a letter, a number, a symbol, a squirrel sound, and a Sanskrit hieroglyph.
Right.
And people just aren't good with that kind of thing.
Well, so, and I've argued with people, they don't seem to agree with me, that limiting the number of possible alternatives reduces security, right?
Huh?
So if you, so of the universe of possible passwords, if you eliminate all the possible passwords that do not have a number in them, you've made the hacker's job easier. They know if your policy says you have to have a number and a password, their password cracking software doesn't need to check those passwords.
Right. And I'm going to demonstrate that as we go through this presentation, because you are correct in that.
The thing is, if you make it so that it's a variable length password, that makes it harder to guess, because like if it could be any number of characters over 16,
right.
That helps. If you don't establish a maximum password size, but you do have a minimum one, that can help.
Yeah, well, if you make, say, you say the minimum is 8 and everybody does 8, that's not good either.
No, what you really want is something variable,
because
that creates a much bigger search space. The thing we ought to be careful about is that there are best practices, and best practices in case you weren't aware of this, is an industry term that means I can't get my ass sued if I do this because it's what everyone else is doing. It doesn't mean it's actually good.
Oh, I didn't.
Minimum best practice is what you're saying.
And I'll give you a classic example of that. How many of you work in an environment where you are required to change your password every 30, 60, 90 days?
90.
We had that at Ford.
Okay. I just had to do it.
So, I have long maintained that that reduces security.
Yeah, I'll agree there, and because I have to have it written down for the first few days.
Of course you do.
What I did was I just used the same password but appended a different number on the end.
Of course you will. Because you're a human being. I mean, what else
except
are you
going to
do?
For our system checks for stuff like that, so I can't do that.
Right.
And that's the most common way that people do their passwords, and the hackers, the crackers know that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Because fundamentally, what would really be much better is force everyone to have a really good password and let them keep it. And if that doesn't make sense to you, I would just challenge you. Tell me what threat you are going to counter by changing everyone's passwords all the time.
So the one that I would suggest is a coworker finds out your password, either through social engineering or something, mm-hmm. and you keep it that same password forever. You know, I know someone who got divorced and there's, you know, ex knew the passwords to all their financial accounts and stuff.
The only thing about a static password is it gives hackers where you need to have, you need to prevent brute force attacks is the only thing on that. If you have something in there that'll prevent brute force attacks, including coming from multiple IPs because of the way you've got all these bots out there.
But changing your password every 90 days does not stop a brute force attack.
Right. Only if the brute force would take more than 90 days would that make sense. But.
So what's going to happen if you need a ton of passwords, you'll use the same one over and over, right? Not what most people do?
I'm sure.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, we really have to design security around understanding human
I'm
nature.
Trying to stop doing that, but I still have not gotten to that.
Uh-huh.
Well, even if you have a password that's based on, like Drew was just a little bit similar password, but you change a number on the end, and they might be able to get that to a brute force much easier.
I'm using KeePass to generate it where I'm trying to do the right thing.
Yep.
Right. Well, one of the first thing I would do is do some triage. All sites are not the same.
Right.
Okay.
Agreed.
So, you go to some place that says, we won't let you comment on a blog post until you create an account. How important is that?
Zero.
Zero.
Well,
as long as you're not using that password there for your bank account at the same time.
Right. Well, so I understand what you're saying, the concept, but I would caution us not to encourage people to not worry about blogging passwords. You want to still protect that because someone could then log in with your ID and post something that's negative or harmful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Possible.
But worst thing it's going to do is get people angry at you.
Yeah.
And I've already got people angry at me for posting my real opinion, so.
Yeah. And as you know, Brian, I am fairly opinionated, so I'm quite.
Yeah, you're more opinionated than me, actually, but. Well, you're more vocal than me, let's put it that way.
So, you know, as an example, when you all remember the Heartbleed SSL thing? And the potential problem there was that if you got the key to a site, you could then log in as an admin and get in there and get a hold of everyone's passwords and stuff like that. It was, oh my God, everyone, change all of your passwords. Bruce Schneier had a very interesting take on all of that. He said, that really doesn't make any sense
at all. Who's Bruce Schneier?
Right.
one of the top security people in the world.
He writes quite a bit of articles.
And he's one of those people who is always very careful and thoughtful.
He may or may not be at Confusion. He probably will be at PenguinCon.
He's been there a number of times.
Okay, so what was his point?
And I got my copy of Schneier on Security signed the last time he was there. So, anyway, Bruce Schneier, I get his blog. It's one of my RSS feeds.
Okay.
So when the Heartbleed thing came out, what he said was, no, you don't change every password you have. You change the ones that matter. Change the password to your bank account, you know. Change the password to your brokerage account, you know. Change the password to your healthcare portal. Mm-hmm. You know, that stuff is things that you want to be careful. You know, your email, you know.
Yeah, because so, your main email account.
Yeah. Those are ones that, you know, because if someone gets in your email account, they can impersonate you a little more plausibly.
They can reset passwords on all your other sites.
As Matt Honan discovered famously. So those should have unique secure passwords, but, you know, what can a cracker do? Well, if they can get into your bank account, for instance, they can wire money from your account to an account in Belarus. You may be liable for the money in that case, not the bank. So, tip. Do you know what things can be done online with your account? Mm-hmm. Have you looked at it? And if logging into the website has the capability of authorizing wire transfers, maybe you should turn that off if that's not something that you ever see yourself doing. Or say, you know, wire transfers only with two physical signatures, and I'll go down to the bank if I ever need to do it. Do something like that. All right? Now, liability is an interesting problem. All right, I'm going to stay there for a second. There have been a few cases involving companies where someone was able to get into the company bank account and do wire transfers of significance. You know, we're talking millions of dollars from a corporate account. And one of the things that companies try and do in that case is say, well, we'll sue the bank to get our money back. Well, in one of those cases, the bank was able to go into court and say, look, we told them, we have the documents right now to prove it, we told them that they were insecure and they refused to do anything about it. And the court said, well then fine, company, you are up a creek.
Yeah.
You were not following best practices. And you were told about it, therefore, you are the one that was negligent. In another case, the bank was found liable because the bank had not followed the best practices, and so the court found that they were negligent. And so I think we're moving towards a kind of a system that says, well, who's really at fault?
Right.
We're going to start seeing this with credit cards as well. After Target, Home Depot, Jimmy John's, all these things, with all these credit card things going on, the banking industry is now forcing a move towards chip and PIN, which has been used in Europe for the last 15 years and significantly reduces fraud. Doesn't eliminate it, but it reduces it very significantly.
So that's like a two-factor. You have to have something, you have to know something.
Right, you have to have the card and know the PIN.
Well, isn't that the same thing that that secure ID thing had? Basically, as long as the chip and PIN is secured information, it's okay. But if the company that holds that information is hacked,
right,
then it's just as bad.
How do you do online ordering then?
Well, that's the weak part. So that's why I said it doesn't eliminate fraud. It
well, then you get a chip reader.
Now, with chip and pin, what this is going to happen is up until now, there's been an understanding that if your credit card is used fraudulently, the bank will not hold you responsible. The banks have said, when we introduce chip and pin, we're going to start transferring that liability. And that liability may go back to you as the consumer, or it may go to the merchant, depending on who was at fault, who was negligent.
Do you have any idea, I mean, I'm just going to be getting mine for my employer, how the employer relationship with the employee would be? So is the employer going to pick up that responsibility, or is the employee, when he's making purchases on behalf of the company?
Probably the employee, because he's the one that's holding the card.
Well, I think that's a question of company policy rather than legal. So, on what I call throwaway sites, I make an online purchase someplace, and let's say I use PayPal. I haven't given them any credit card information at all. I don't know that I'll ever be back there again. I really don't care. I can just give them, you know, a six-letter password that I use for all of these sites, and it's not that important. If it's a blog, it's not that important. Yeah?
I just heard on radio, I think a couple days ago, do you know why there's a four-digit PIN on ATM machines?
No.
Apparently the guy that developed them, his wife could not remember the six-digit PIN that he wanted to use.
Oh, that's great. I love that.
Well, you know, there's lots of little stories like that in history, but it's going to be interesting. So, you know, some of these things are based on, you know, the specific capabilities at that point in time, and then we're stuck with it much later on.
Yeah.
I was just reading that Obama's going to be talking about cybersecurity all this week. Well, this is his big
thing.
It's
sort of like, you know, why are terminals 80 characters wide on a line? It's because the original IBM punch card was 80 columns.
Yep.
So, now, how crackers work. First, it's got to find a way to get in, and that could be a targeted attack on an individual. This is called spear phishing. It's getting very, very sophisticated. You know, you identify someone, and so, you know, this particular executive is a golf fanatic. I'll send him an email that has a link to a, you know, golf weekend, you know, special, blah, 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 and he'll click on it because he'll fall for it. And then, you know, we'll get in and we'll get all the access he has. It could be a weakness in the online network. Maybe it's a privilege elevation attack that they can get in there. You know, in the case of Target, it was going through the point of sale system. So they're able to get through that into the network, and then once they're in the network, what they're after is the database. The database that has all of those lovely, lovely passwords. So, your worst case scenario, they've stored the passwords as clear text. Well, it's game over at that point. They've now got 100% of all the passwords.
Yeah.
How can you tell? Well, a possible sign is when they limit the length of the password. Because what that may mean is that the database administrator had set up a fixed length field to store the password. And if it was only 8 characters and you type in 9 and you get an error, I'd be really worried at that point. That's not a good sign. Now,
what if they just truncate anything after 8 but don't tell you they're doing it?
And here's how you test that. If they truncate, let's say you've typed in a 12 character password, but they're only storing the first 8, try typing in just the first 11 characters. If that lets you in, you know right away that's what they're doing. Now, that was the worst case scenario. Let's assume we're doing a little bit better here. We're employing hashing. Now, hashing is an example of what's called a one-way function mm-hmm. in mathematics. One-way functions are very easy to compute, but we call it infeasible to do the reverse.
Right.
And when we talked about brute force attacks, a brute force attack is reversing this. And I'll get into the mathematics of this as we get along here. Also, it should be infeasible to modify the original without modifying the hash. I won't